is Cigdem Yuksel, and I'm from Turkey, Gülhane Medical Academy. I'm a mental health nurse with PhD degree, and I'm going to talk about transition between child and adolescent mental health services and adult mental health services. Well, I think it's going to be a boring presentation after him, but I'm going to try my best. Okay. Although child and adolescent transition from child and adolescent services to adult services has received much attention in the field of physical health, little attention has addressed the transition process in mental health services, unfortunately. Nonetheless, children and adolescents often struggle to move between child and adolescent mental health services, I've called CAMHS, and adult mental health services, I've called AMHS, and in particular, they're poorly supported. There's a growing evidence base for interventions with children and adolescents, but transition in mental health settings is still the area where the evidence base is scant. A number of detailed international community guidelines is produced to guide intervention in mental health problems occurring in children and adolescents, but still, there is some difference among them. It's important to use best practice guidelines to close the gap between current operational practice and evidence-based practice in transition. And this research, the aim was to provide a critical review around through screening literature for guidelines released between 1-1-2 about transition between child and adolescent mental health services and adult mental health services, and to describe the basic steps of effective transition in common. Google database were screened between some links with the keywords of National Translation Guideline, CAMHS, and some research restriction in all in text. As a result of the screening, a total of 36 guidelines were obtained and 11 suitable results were taken into consideration. There was a striking sentence when I looked up guidelines and I want to share with you. The adolescent site says, I had a very bad transition from CAMHS to adult services. One day, I was in place with plenty of support, and then the next, the only support I knew was a crisis number. It took over 6 months for me to have a proper assessment and be assigned a care coordinator, by which time I had suffered a complete loss in my condition. So there are some common issues in those guidelines. The first one is transition period. It's a period between the age of 16, young persons seem to have a capacity and has a right to consent or withhold consent to medical, including psychiatry to 24 years of age. And preparation should ideally begin 6 months before the young person is due to leave the CAMHS service. Responsibilities are placed on practitioners and mentors in both things, those in service from which the young person must transition and those in the community. And there are some headlines that are telling us the basic common issues. The first one is involving the young individual and family for transition plans. It's important to keep in mind that mental health service transitions are processed rather than simply transferred. The young person and their family are the key decision makers regarding the services they receive. The needs of the service users should be the central to protocol and the service developer regarding the transition. While young people who have reached middle and late adolescence are able to decide for themselves how much they want their family involved, a family-inclusive approach should be encouraged whenever possible. If adolescents are unwilling or unable to have their family involved, the friends and the other non-family support people should be considered in the transition planning process. Transition planning is a structured process that begins when a young person first engages with their service and continues for as long as they remain engaged with that service, and at least 6 months before the discharge from CAMHS, as well as managing realistic expectations for the input from adult services. We should refer the young people to age-appropriate accessible services where they exist, and tell commissioners and providers where they don't exist. For example, some young people may not meet the criteria for severe and enduring mental health illness and thus may not be eligible for AMHS. We should offer young people additional and alternative support to AMHS, including support from non-health settings. voluntary sector services, private health care, and other universal services.
I've never sworn this guy.
Okay. And the other one is working in collaboration with other professions and agencies. A transition should be done as a part of collaborative care planning and shared decision-making approach. We should work collaboratively with other professions and agencies. Staff should know how each other's services operate in order to provide a coordinated and joint up care. The young person and their parents should be given realistic information about the services that would be likely to be delivered and the services to which they may be moving. If the young person has received a multimodal treatment, but this unlikely to be delivered in the adult service, this information should be shared to help the young person to have realistic expectations. The young person and their parents should be given some written information about their condition and about their proposed service. The young people often feel that they do not receive accurate information at the right time for them. One of the most important aspects of transition planning is ensuring that communication is clear between the service and the young person and the family, primary level services, and the other key stakeholders, and that is communication takes place in a timely manner. This includes ensuring that the information communicated is clearly documented and relevant to the role and responsibility of the service or person receiving the information, and that the young person and their family agree to the information being shared and who it will be shared with. And the other one is managing service transition process. It can be seen at a time of increased risk. Pairs of transitions are recognized as a time of increased risk for service users and need to be managed as effectively as possible. It is aimed to speed up the assessment and transfer process as well as to increase the transparency of decision making to patients. Patients would be assessed in 7 working days of referral and decision communicated to work and patient. Ensure safe transfer of patients between wards and improve patient experience by providing prompt feedback to patients. Managing the service transition process should be flexible it should be a managed process with planning and assessment. Continuity of care and follow-up is important, and a period of shared and parallel care is that means good practice. SSE needs letting to perform a more central role in care plan means having something to aim for, giving the young, ensuring continuity of care, giving the young an aim to enable to plan for the future and foster life beyond the engagement with mental services. And participation in all aspects of planning for the treatment and follow up, developing plans moving on front of the service and type of services. The service should seek the continuity, identify and review the goals of service delivery with the aim of supporting the young person to progress to a less intense model of service delivery, including self-care, nature, community supports. And we should follow up and monitor outcomes following the discharge from CAMHS, including those young people who don't transfer at AMHS, and audit, review, and evaluate our practice and service models and for the young people, families, and carers. Focusing on the home life of the child and the adolescent is important in assessing needs and planning conversation, including with family, friends, housing, school, college, and work that affects overall well-being. So, if we have poor service transition, that means we have same age for mental health services, that means average outcomes in mental health, and the young person's health and well-being changes, and parents and carers. Carers and wider families helping and have the value chance to. So proper planning transition may improve the mental health outcomes for child and adolescents. Thank you.
Okay. Quite often in adult services, there isn't the provision of the young person. doctors, trainee physicians, trainee pediatricians, people involved in the psychiatric services, how do we get this across so that we can implement it? You know, I sort of feel like at least the beginning, the training of people working with to support those in mental health.
Yeah, I think it should be in, what can I say, in the programs of education. But when I'm a lecturer in the nursing school at the same time about mental health or something. But when I see the books, we teach lots of things from the books. But when the nurse goes to the area, the clinical area, they're not using this knowledge. They're not working evidence-based. So I think the problem is, there's a great gap between the knowledge and the practice. I think we have to solve the problem by putting those protocols into practice. In my opinion, all healthcare workers are learning to touch people when they come to clinical area. So if it's a rule in the clinical area to use those kind of protocols, that nurse, that doctor, that psychiatrist learn and use those kind of things. I think it's not enough to put them into the program of nursing college now. We should really use them in real life, in clinics, so they're going to use them.